Good morning and welcome to the 20th meeting of 2023 in Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. This morning we have received apologies from Annie Wells and Paul O'Kane. Our first agenda item is to decide whether to take Agenda Item 4 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you, members. Moving on to Agenda Item 2, we are going to be doing our pre-budget scrutiny. This is the evidence session where we have a citizens panel from the Whole Family Equality Project, and I refer members to Papers 1 and 2. Now, we have all met previously before during an engagement session, and I'm delighted to welcome you back. And I do realise that this is more a formal of a setting than our previous meeting. So I shall introduce myself and then invite the other committee members to introduce themselves as well. So my name is Kokab Stewart, and I am the convener of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee.
Hi everyone, I'm Maggie Chapman and I'm the deputy convener of this committee.
Good morning everyone, I'm Karen Adam, MSP.
Good morning.
Good morning everyone, Megan Gallagher, MSP.
Thank you members. So now if each one of our panels would like to briefly introduce themselves, I think we'll go from left to right as I see it. So John, please.
Hi everyone, my name is Yam. You can call me John.
Thank you.
Good morning everyone, my name is Justin.
Hi, welcome. I am Erica.
Hi, I'm Sharma.
Good morning, my name is Afam.
Thank you, and once again, you are very welcome. I know that you are supported by other members of your group in the public gallery as well, and we welcome them too, recognising their input in enabling us to be in this position today. I do understand that John is going to make an opening statement, and then each of you will in turn read out a question or questions that you would like us as a committee to put to the Minister for Equalities, Migration and Refugees in our session later this morning. So, John, are you all right to begin your statement? Thank you.
Thank you. In August 2022, the citizen panel was established as part of the Whole Family Equality Project of Capital Citizen Partnership. The panel brings together representatives from ethnically diverse and economically disadvantaged communities, aiming to create a space where we can combine our lived experience to advise a better practice for service provider. Over the last year, we have shared our lived experience and worked with a variety of partners, producing some powerful insights in order to address socioeconomic disparity. We have begun to engage in wider decision-making forums and developed ourselves into a consultative body, rooted in a right-based principle that places the human rights of individual front and centre. In August 2023, we embarked on participation in the Scottish Parliament pre-budget scrutiny work with Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. So throughout the process, we acquired knowledge of the budget process, the Equalities Committee's role and the integration of equality principles into policy. We also familiarised ourselves with ministerial responsibilities related to equality within portfolios. Our active involvement includes sharing experience, practical discussion, and formulating pertinent questions representing communities' priorities. This question may touch on various committees' areas, such as housing or education, but our primary lens is equality. So we hope that by sharing our lived experience, we can encourage meaningful consideration of financial resources utilization in order to improve inequality. Our goal is to represent a bridge between the committee and the communities we serve, facilitating open dialogue and collaboration for the betterment of all. Finally, we are aware that this new approach of consultation for the participation and communities team, so we would like to take a moment to say how much we enjoy the process and we are eagerly looking forward to actively participating in any opportunity that arises, not only to enhance our service, but also to participate in advocacy library budget scrutiny in the future. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, John. That was very, very helpful to the committee. I would like to now hand over to Justin. And Justin, I believe that you're going to give the question that you would like us to ask to the minister. And then I will leave it to you to introduce the next person who will be asking a question after yourself. Thank you, Justin.
Thank you very much. Once again, my name is Justin. Thank you for this opportunity. The panel thinks that the Universal Bus Pass policy has been a great way to tackle inequality and poverty, and that a similar approach should be used for free school meals, including removing stigma and barriers that by taking away token schemes and raising the age for free meals to 18. And now, here's the question. What has the minister done to work with the Minister for Children, Young People, and Keeping the Promise to understand the equalities impact of the current approach to free school meals? And will she commit to carrying out work on understanding how cross-cutting successes like the Universal Bus Pass can be replicated in other policy areas to alleviate inequality? Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Who would you like to go next?
Okay. Erica.
Erica.
The panel think it's important that Scottish government ministers work together to find ways to close the poverty gap without people having to rely on charities and social security payments. Keeping the promise is one way that children and families could be supported, but it must be delivered by a diverse workforce. And my question is, can the minister explain how she is working with the Minister for Children, Young People, and Keeping the Promise to ensure that the promise considers, reflects, and supports the cultural and ethnic diversity of all of Scotland's children?
Thank you. Thank you, Erica.
Shama?
Thank you.
The panel has strong concerns about the ethnic minority pay gap, both for children growing up in Scotland and for the new Scots, and supporting people from ethnic minorities throughout their lifetime. We know that 2/3 of immigrants to Scotland have a degree, yet there still remains a significant pay gap. My question is, how is the minister taking a cross-portfolio approach to closing the ethnic minority pay gap, including working with ministerial colleagues to make sure there are equal employability opportunities for school leavers and monitoring the ethnic minority pay gap, especially in the context of anti-racist employment strategy? Thank you.
Thank you, Shama. Afam?
Is that both questions? Okay, sorry. My name is Afam, thank you. The panel feels very positively about the opportunity it has had to participate in the budget process and would like to see more of this work being done, especially by the Scottish Government. And my question is, how does the minister connect directly with communities and how, how will she work with the colleagues to make sure that there are more participation and opportunities across the portfolios, including policy education, awareness, raising of engagement, opportunities, and feedback on the outcomes of engagement? Thank you.
Thank you. Did you have another question that you wished to put as well? Shama, thank you.
The panel feels that many people, especially those from diverse ethnic backgrounds, are unaware of what makes their basic human rights, especially when they have moved to Scotland as adults. My question is, can the minister outline her commitment to ensure all communities and people of all ages, including new Scots, and are educated on their human rights by explaining the opportunities that the new upcoming Human Rights Bill will bring, including how the bill may link to national indicators and measuring the process of existing quality and anti-racism strategies? Thank you.
Thank you very much. John, is there a question that you were...
Yes. Our panel have concerns that even though diversity education in personal, social, health, economic classes has a lot of details on issues like sexuality, race, and gender, there is a little reflection or understanding of cultural differences. So here's the question. How is the minister working with the Minister for Children, Young People, and keeping promise to ensure that teachers have appropriate equalities and diversity training to fully support the teaching of cultural diversity and delivering PSU in a culturally sensitive way? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. Thank you to all of you for such thoughtful questions. We now have time for a short discussion on how you have found the experience of participating and engaging with the committee. But first, I want to ask any committee member if they have a particular question from our panellists that they would be happy to put to the minister in our next session. And we have given it some thought prior to that. Maggie?
So just to say good morning and welcome to the committee. Again, thank you for coming along and thank you for the time that you've put into preparing for the session today. We've been talking about how we will ask your questions. And Sharma, I'm going to ask the two questions that you've just read out on your behalf and on behalf of the panel members to the minister. And I suppose one of my questions just in my mind as I ask, when you were thinking about the question, are there any examples or any bit of your lived experience or the panel's lived experience that you'd like me to keep in my mind as I'm asking the question?
Can I pass the answer to Jean, please?
Okay. It's okay.
Yeah, just a little bit of thinking time, I suppose, for the panel is that I think that it would be helpful for us as committee members to have a little bit of insight in what made you think to ask that particular question, if you have an interest in that area or an example that you'd like to share with us. But you don't have to. Justin, could I bring you in?
Erica would.
Regarding the second question Sharma asked, my input is that I think often when people move to Scotland from other countries, they don't know about their rights here. And it would be great to see that the government launches programs that help to raise awareness on human rights and just in general to educate us. And I think the responsibility lies on both sides, but it would be great to get more support.
Thank you, Erica. That's really, really helpful to bear that in mind.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Caden?
Thank you, Chair, and thank you to the panel for your questions. And I'm going to be asking a question today on behalf of AFAM, and I would just like to ask you if there is anything that I should keep in mind while asking this question. I'm particularly going to be focusing on participation and on that topic.
Thank you. I had to think quite a bit about my particular question with the word communities and engagement. And personally, I think the word communities kind of separates the person from the observer from communities. I like the idea of, like the citizens panel, the community is in the parliament as well. We are part of the community, including the MSPs, everyone. And it would be nice, from our experience as the panel, to be more involved with different portfolios and then feed that back to the communities, the wider community. Seeing and experiencing, discussing ideas, lived experiences with MSPs close up, sharing the environment of idea with everyone else. I think it's made a difference, and I think it changes the definition of communities. And overarching that all would be human rights, which kind of is the guidelines for it. Thank you.
Thank you. Actually, really helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Megan.
Thank you very much, Convener, and I have the pleasure this morning of asking John's question to the Minister in relation to understanding of different cultures and how we start that in the classroom, because I think that's a really important important understanding that I think that we all need to grasp, but also in terms of legislation that comes through the Scottish Parliament and the impacts that that could have on our various diverse communities that we have throughout Scotland. So I'm just wondering, and just to make sure that we're asking the Minister absolutely the right questions, is there anything that we could do to help improve that understanding? And is there anything that perhaps John or the panel has maybe thought about that we could bring into the committee or indeed our structures within the Scottish Parliament to make sure that culture and our cultural differences, but also our cultural, you know, in terms of what we actually do share as a community, that we can bring into the Parliament.
Right. Before that, do anyone have any idea first?
Just a little.
Yeah.
Okay. When it comes to education and especially children, we're at the beginning of influence with regards to understanding other people. I think the word cultural and differences is, for kickoff, is actually causing a problem. We as human beings, we are one, to cause the cliche, but actually to expose ourselves to the different languages and the different cultures and the geographical evolution of why there is a difference in skin colour, language, what language is, why is it different? I think it's an important subject. It should be at the base of everything. It will give us more tolerance. John.
Right. So for me, I think that particular issue is more on how the government monitor the school curriculum in terms of how they implement the whole education. So I've read through some kind of articles about that. So it's found out that the level of unsuitable material in the use in school, that particular problem would still happening here. And there is a narrative experience where the parents who has their daughters who being told in create a model of kind of sexual models, male sexual models in a mixed sex classroom. So I would feel that is because on the human rights and cultural difference and more on the sexuality rights, that's kind of different thing. I think monitor of the curriculum on how the teacher can train the student or educate the student, that particular problem would be really, really careful to do with. Because as Avam said, children is our future, right? So it's the beginning of the diversity. So I think that how we choose the material and what the way that we teach them is very important. Thank you.
No, thank you very much. And certainly that's, you know, my concerns as well. You know, I've had those concerns as well. So thank you so much. Tolerance, parental engagement. I think we've got it, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Justin?
Yes, I'd like to add to what John just said by also emphasising the need for the teachers for constant training and retraining of the teachers and those who educate our children and young people, because children are our future. Okay, so and if we really want to achieve equalities, diversities across board, it has to start from the way we teach the children. So emphasis also has to be given to the teachers so that the vision of equalities across the whole of Scotland can be achieved within the shortest possible time. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, John. Sorry, Justin, I beg your pardon. I will go next. I have the pleasure of asking Erica your question. Is there anything further that you wish to sort of let me know about that question or your thoughts around it? You don't have to, but you would like to add something. Thank you.
Yeah, just a little bit. So one of the reasons that we were thinking to ask this question and we want the committee to ask this question is because the panel thinks that it would be great to see ethnic minority groups being represented in different work areas, for example, on children's hearing panels.
much for that. That's very helpful. And just to reassure you, Afam, your question will be asked by my colleague Fulton McGregor, who is on his way to the Parliament as we speak. So he will be coming in a little bit through when the minister starts. He's just running late, so we're all right. Are there any? We've got a few minutes left. So is there any further comment that the panelists would like to add at this point? I suppose from the committee's point of view, we're particularly interested in if the Parliament can do anything further to support citizens like yourself to be able to talk confidently about budget provisions. Is there anything further that could be done? If you don't have an answer just now, that's okay. Please do feedback to us. And my other question, while you think about that one, is how do you think that more people could get involved in work like this? What could we do to enable that to happen? And I know, Afam, you indicated that you would like to say something.
I'd like to answer all of them, actually, but I'll just take the one.
We've got a couple of minutes.
Answerable. Actually, I've got thrown because there's so many good questions. I guess with regards to, because I'm based around the community question, it's really easy for us, the panel, to as one, to answer the question about improving community engagement. We sat in some of the luxurious offices in here and discussed, argued, shared our lived experiences, and MSPs were walking past us looking in, wondering what was going on. Some were interested. That's community engagement. So in a way, we've come to you. You just need to open the door and walk in or ask to be able to sit in and listen to the discussions that are going on. I think a lot of the times, I think MSPs are misunderstood. They are human beings as well. And the contact is lost through many hoops to jump through. So I think that to improve the engagement with the community is to have panels like ourselves having our meetings in here, because that's what this is for, and sharing our lives with yourselves to help you, to help the MSPs to get through such difficult times.
Thank you for that. That's very helpful and a valuable insight. You are correct that our meeting rooms, the Parliament is built on transparency and accountability, and MSPs do in fact walk past. Quite a powerful point that you've made about having that door open, and that they can actually walk in and listen directly themselves. So thank you for making that point. That's great. Now, Fulton has joined us. I will just give you a couple of minutes to just sort of find your feet. You are going to be asking Justin's question. So are you happy to sort of, would you like any further information from Justin regarding why they may have picked that particular question? That's what the rest of the committee members were asking. But you don't have to. We're coming to the end of this session, so...
Yeah, not particularly. It was an area I was quite keen to follow up, because I know that when we done the engagement sessions, that it was a pretty big area around about bus passes and also other universal access. But I would just give yourself the opportunity, Justin, to say if there's anything else. You've seen the question, obviously, and I know that you're happy with that question. You've been working in partnership with the team here to draft the question. But if there's anything else you want to get across to me just now before the minister comes in.
Okay, thank you very much. At the level of the panel, we agreed to bring that particular and the rest of the other questions because of we saw the importance primarily based on our lived experiences, okay, our engagement within our communities, feedbacks from children who go to schools. We see some children finding it difficult to understand that, how can't I eat with my friend? It's lunchtime, my friend isn't eating. I am eating, or my friend is eating something else different from mine. But when it comes to lectures, we sit together. If we can sit together and study together, why can't we eat together? Okay, so we took this, among other feedbacks, to get to our discussion sections, and we found out that something that has worked effectively very well is the bus pass policy. It kind of it equalizes everybody, and it makes it easier for, irrespective of your status, your ethnicity, everybody uses the bus pass, and it's worked very well. Okay, so we thought if the minister can probably look at that aspect as well and find a way to balance the free school meals, probably a cap of 18 years can be placed so that irrespective of your ethnicity, irrespective of your status, okay, every child is entitled to free school meals. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Thank you very much. That brings us to the end of this part of the meeting, and I would just like to repeat our very sincere thanks to our panellists this morning. I know that you're going to take a seat now in the gallery to observe the following session that we have with the Minister, and I know that you're going to be watching and making sure that we ask your questions, and you will be in the room to hear the answers directly yourselves. So I will be suspending the meeting very briefly in order to allow for a change of panellists. Thank you very much. Our next agenda item is a pre-budget scrutiny session, and I welcome to the meeting this morning Emma Roddick, the Minister for Equalities, Migration and Refugees, Rob Priestley, who is the Head of Mainstreaming and Strategy Unit, Directorate of Equality, Inclusion and Human Rights, and Fee Robertson, Head of the Scottish Budget Team, Directorate of Budget and Public Spending, Scottish Government. Welcome to all three of you this morning. So I refer members to paper three, and in welcoming you, Minister, as you will be aware, the committee has been engaging with a citizens panel from the Whole Family Equality Project as part of our participatory approach to pre-budget scrutiny. And in our session earlier, representatives from the panel who are seated in the gallery behind you, they gave us some questions that they would like us to ask you. And we will go straight into those questions now. And I should be very clear that these questions are on behalf of the whole panel, but each member of that panel, of our committee, will say who introduced that question in our session earlier. So we have agreed the questions that we are going to ask on behalf of which panellist member, and the Minister will then respond. I'm sure that it will go very well. And just to put on the record that the questions that we are asking, Minister, are verbatim on behalf of the panellists. We thought it was very important that our panellist voices were put front and centre of this pre-budget scrutiny session. So, in the light of that, what we will do is we'll kick off with the questions, and it's me that's going to go first. So I am asking in that sense, it's not me at all, in fact, it's Erica. So Erica's question was around the fact that the panel think it's important that the Scottish Government ministers work together in ways to close the poverty gap without people having to rely on charities and social security payments. Keeping the promise is one way that children and families can be supported, but it must be delivered by a diverse workforce. So could the Minister explain how she is working with the Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise to ensure that the promise considers, reflects and supports the cultural and ethnic diversity of all of Scotland's children?
Fantastic question to kick things off. Thank you very much, Convener. And I'm very aware that the citizens panel members are behind me and I feel a bit rude. So just apologies to everyone behind me, but I do need to address the convener. But I completely appreciate the work that's been put in here and that these questions are coming from members of the public. So possibly even more difficult to answer than usual. But I'll just emphasise from the beginning that my portfolio is Equalities, Migration and Refugees. So I will do my very best to answer these questions within the scope of that remit, although I understand that Equalities is so broad and it might be quite difficult to tie things in, but certainly I'm more than happy to bring in officials and we're happy to write to other ministers and directorates as appropriate to get the committee fuller answers if needed, if we're going into depth on colleagues' portfolios. In terms of working with Natalie Dawn around the promise, you'll be aware, Convener, that there was a programme for government commitment to set up a cabinet subcommittee on the promise. Now, the membership of that is still a work in progress, but I think it is a demonstration of the wider mainstreaming approach that we are taking. While the promise is, of course, not my area of responsibility, I am committed to ensuring that equality and human rights is embedded, that all that we do in government, including the delivery of the promise. So we're delivering that change in a number of ways. You'll be aware of the Human Rights Bill. Of course, the consultation has just recently closed on our proposals there. So legislating on those human rights will ensure that, among other things, the Scottish Government is taking a human rights-based approach in how we legislate and also how we are treating our citizens. We're reforming the public sector equality duty, which will make sure that other public bodies are acting in the same way. We are focusing on building capacity and changing culture within government and strengthening leadership, including at senior levels, and making better use of the equality data that we have. So thinking about our ambition that Scotland is an equal and fair place for any child to grow up, no matter their background, I will continue to work with colleagues, including the Minister for Children and Young People, and keeping the promise to ensure that we are meeting that across all our services, be it care, health, social, education. So that will require lots of portfolios to work together, which is reflected in the need for the Cabinet Subcommittee.
Thank you for that, Minister. I think with our communications with the panellists and during this participatory process, what has come through is that members of the public don't see the portfolios in silos, that actually their lives are interconnected, and lots of issues impact, you know, for instance, housing, education, they all cross over. So from their point of view, you know, their question is regarding the different portfolios and different departments working together in order to have a budget that is relevant and appropriate in that way. Is there anything further that either yourself or maybe Rob could give us information about delivering a diverse workforce? And I think the intent behind that question was that if you have a diverse workforce, then that is very reflective of the diversity of the children that they're going to be working with. So any one of the panels, certainly. Minister, would you like to?
Yes, certainly. And of course, I understand, particularly with Equalities, there's so much crossover. And I think that's reflected in the cross-government work that we're constantly undertaking. My only fear would be trying to go into detail on processes that I'm not party to on behalf of colleagues who could possibly come to this committee themselves and be far more helpful in that regard. In terms of a diverse workforce, I think it's a very important point. But as you'll know, convener, teachers do have to comply with professional values, integrity, trust, respect, and social justice. So all teachers should be being positive role models and ensuring that everyone they encounter is treated with respect. More specifically around an anti-racism approach to employment overall, you'll be aware that last December we published our new anti-racist employment strategy, which seeks to respond to the scale of institutional racism. The strategy provides practical guidance and support to help employers take an anti-racist and intersectional approach to addressing racial inequality in the workplace. Rob, I don't know if there's anything else you would like to add on.
Yeah, there is work underway on, particularly we're looking specifically at Scottish Government and civil servants, there's work underway on diversifying the civil service workforce, which I don't have details on with me, but I'd be happy to have colleagues write to the committee and provide some more information on that, which relates directly to Scottish Government civil service work. And then more broadly, that then feeds into the work the Minister's always already referred to under the mainstreaming work, which is how do we support other public bodies to equally, sometimes learning from them, sometimes supporting, equally work on diversifying the workforce. The knowledge and understanding of that workforce is also critical.
Thank you. Thank you for those responses. I know myself, especially in the teaching profession, there have been many, many initiatives over the years to increase the diversity of the workforce. And unfortunately, I think we would all admit that we're not making the progress in that area that we would like to see. But it is heartening to hear the continued work and the focus of the Scottish Government on that. And on that note, I'd like to pass over to my colleague, Megan.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning, panel. John is the author of my question today, and John says that the panel has concerns that even though diversity education in PSHE classes has a lot of detail on issues like sexuality, race and gender, there is little reflection or understanding of cultural differences. So John asks, how is the Minister working with the Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise to ensure that teachers have the appropriate equalities and diversity training to fully support the teaching of cultural diversity and delivering PSHE in a culturally sensitive way?
I thank the committee and the panel again for a very in-depth question. I would hesitate to take such a broad brush approach, I suppose. I know that there are very good examples of PSHE led by very hardworking teachers across Scotland. And as I mentioned, all teachers are expected, required to adhere to the GTCS professional values. So they should be demonstrating welcoming, encouraging and inclusive behaviours to ensure that everybody within schools is treated with respect. And it's the responsibility of all staff, not just teachers in Scottish schools, to promote and facilitate that culture of equality and diversity and address individual and also institutional discrimination, including where that stems from cultural differences. A specific example I can give of us delivering appropriate training for teachers is that we're currently consulting on revised statutory teaching guidance for relationships, sexual health and parenthood education, aimed at enabling children and young people to build positive relationships as they age. So I appreciate, as the convener alluded to, you know, diversity education has come a long way in 20 years, but there's still so much work to do, and we do recognise that, and I welcome this scrutiny of that aspect, and I additionally welcome the approach that my colleague, the Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise, is taking with the statutory guidance to help ensure that teachers are empowered to deliver PSHE education in a culturally sensitive way.
Thank you. You know, the word, the phrase there, culturally sensitive, is perhaps one of the most important aspects of this, because we certainly want young people from all different backgrounds to feel included, not excluded. And I think that's the narrative that's certainly coming through here. So do you think a review into PHAC formats in terms of teaching is appropriate? So we're looking at this new dynamic of diverse learning. Do you think that would be appropriate to look at, to make sure that we're including all cultures in the classroom, not just the cultures that we might have here within the Scottish Parliament?
It's not something that I can go into great detail about here, I hope you'll appreciate, because it's not an area of responsibility that sits with me. But I know that the Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise is as keen as the rest of government to ensure that we're doing all we can around promoting that diverse culture within schools. So more than happy to pass on any comments from committee, these and any others in the education portfolio, to her, to make her aware of the asks from committee and the citizens panel. The only thing I would add, I suppose, that is within my responsibility area is that we are doing lots of work at pace at the moment to launch the Anti-Racism Observatory. And I think what will happen there is the data and the guidance, the evidence base that we can get from that institution will allow us to respond to the systemic issues that we know exist, and policy that is based on this new evidence that has previously not been collected, perhaps as much as it should have or could have, will allow us to be truly anti-racism as well as simply not racist.
Thank you, Minister. And I'm just wondering, Convener, that this might be for private session, perhaps maybe a follow-up letter to the Minister for Children, Young People, keeping the promise, just to mirror what we've asked the Minister this morning.
Thank you. Happy to discuss that. That's fine. Minister, you mentioned the observatory there. Since you brought that up, can I ask where we are in the process with that? What status is the observatory in at the moment? And at what point, because these are questions that have been raised to me regarding the observatory, at what point will we see an impact?
So you'll appreciate that I'm working very closely with the Anti-Racism Interim Governance Group co-chairs around what exactly the observatory will look like, kind of functions and the constitution of the body. So I'm not in a position where I can share all of that with committee at the moment, but I will of course keep you updated as things move along. But we are, as I say, moving at pace, and as reflected in the programme for government, in a position at the moment that we expect to be launching the observatory by the end of the year.
Ah, well, that would be great. Thank you very much. I shall move on to my colleague, Maggie.
Thank you very much, Kirkheb. And good morning, Minister. Good morning to your officials. I have two questions that I am going to put to you on behalf of Sharma from the panel. And the first one is, Sharma writes, the panel has strong concerns about the ethnic minority pay gap, both for children growing up in Scotland and for new Scots, and feel that closing this gap is crucial to closing the poverty gap and supporting people from ethnic minorities throughout their lifetime. We know that 2/3 of immigrants to Scotland have a degree, yet there still remains a significant pay gap. So Sharma's question is, how is the Minister taking a cross-portfolio approach to closing the ethnic minority pay gap, including working with ministerial colleagues to make sure there are equal employability opportunities for school leavers and monitoring the ethnic minority pay gap, especially in the context of the anti-racist employment strategy?
Again, really appreciate the spirit of the question, and I think this goes back to what Megan Gallagher and I were just discussing, is institutional racism, systemic change, the need for which has only grown as we become more aware of its effect on people, including those seeking to work in Scotland. Very simply, we want Scotland to be a place where anyone has equal opportunity to enter, sustain and progress in work in an inclusive labour market. Going back to December 2022, when we published our new anti-racist employment strategy, that's also underpinned by a series of actions that we are undertaking in partnership with key stakeholders, including evaluation of the minority ethnic recruitment toolkit to ensure that it continues to support employers in their recruitment of people from racialised minority backgrounds, development of the next stage of our anti-racism workplace training framework, which will support public and private employers to assess their own training needs and provide learning pathways that will build the capability of employers to address racial inequality in their workplace, and guidance to show how employers have used positive action to address underrepresentation, retention and progression of staff within their workforce. Now, we'll continue to encourage and support public sector leadership to build that understanding of institutional racism and its impact, and to address the recommendations of this committee's inquiry into race equality, employment and skills. This has all, of course, been taken forward in the context of our new Fair Work Action Plan, which will meet our ambition of becoming a leading Fair Work nation by 2025.
Thank you, Minister, for that response. There are quite a few bits and pieces in there, and actually in reference to one of your earlier answers about the Anti-Racism Observatory, I think there's a challenge that this committee has heard time and time again, year after year, that we don't necessarily have the right data, and we don't monitor effectively in terms of comparable data, either geographically or sectorally, or you know, any other stratifications that we might need to. So, how with the anti-racist employment strategy and the action plan that you've outlined, and I suppose it's linked into the Fair Work Action Plan. What are the relationships between those strategies and the anti-racist observatory? Because there's no point in all of this good work going on if it doesn't join up, if it doesn't connect, and we don't actually see the impact of good work and where the gaps and where things are falling through the cracks.
I think that's exactly the point. That's exactly what we're trying to do here. Is, you know, COVID was not the only or the first example of where not having that data on intersectional inequalities led to poorer outcomes for different groups. But it's certainly what brought the AIGG together, which eventually recommended the Anti-Racism Observatory. So the impact of that will be far more wide-ranging than simply addressing only the inequalities that became clear through the pandemic. In terms of it connecting, I think it's important to note that the observatory is not, you know, the answer to racial inequality. It is part of the solution, and what it will allow us to do is to create stronger evidence-based policy. In terms of getting data, it's also not the only approach that we're taking, recognising that intersectional data requirement. You'll be aware that we're also at the moment looking at reviewing the operation of the public sector equality duty. So I recently wrote to stakeholders outlining the next steps around that, and that included two key regulatory changes, including revising the current pay gap reporting duty to include reporting on ethnicity pay gaps. Pay gap reporting, of course, being an important means of driving that action to spotlight and reduce pay inequalities affecting certain disadvantaged groups, and extending that requirement to report on pay gaps between men and women to include reporting on pay gaps relating to disability and ethnicity. That will encourage public bodies to take more effective action on equalities issues affecting their disabled and minoritised staff.
Thank you for that. I mean, I think one of the challenges we have is, you know, yes, we've identified gaps in data, and I think you've explained some of the work underway to plug those gaps. But in terms of evidence-based policy, we already have the evidence. We already have evidence of inequality, and I would urge focus on action rather than just, you know, collecting stuff that we already know is problematic. I take on board what you say about things having to work together and some of these strategies being new. So I'm sure I speak for the committee. We would welcome updates on the different strands of work that you've outlined in that over the course, maybe not only as part of our pre-budget scrutiny, but ongoing. I'll move on to my next question.
Yeah, move on to your second question, please.
So this question is also from Sharma. And she writes that the panel feels that many people, especially those from diverse ethnic backgrounds, are unaware of what constitutes their basic human rights, especially when they have moved to Scotland as adults. Can the minister outline her commitment to ensuring all communities and people of all ages, including new Scots, are educated on their human rights by explaining the opportunities that the upcoming Human Rights Bill will bring, including how the bill might link to national indicators and measuring the progress of existing equality and anti-racism strategies?
I'm glad to hear the word opportunity there to describe the process of the Human Rights Bill coming forward, because that is an important and exciting part of what we're doing here. It's not simply about incorporating these four treaties into Scots laws as far as we can, but it is an opportunity also to inform people and raise awareness about the rights that they have and will have once the treaties are incorporated. So I think implementing the legislation effectively and communicating it effectively will be as important as passing this very ambitious piece of legislation. And that's why we've established an implementation working group to develop early thinking in this space, including on how to best raise awareness of the rights within the bill. I think it's essential that the work here is targeted. So we're ensuring that those communities who may at the moment be furthest from accessing those rights, furthest from power, have a greater understanding of what the bill does for them. The bill itself will create a duty on ministers to publish a human rights scheme, which will require regular reporting on what Scottish ministers are doing to implement the bill, including on awareness raising. So we'll continue to develop our thinking on how this links to the National Performance Framework, as well as broader work across government, including on anti-racism.
Thank you. And I appreciate what you say about this being a work in progress, and the discussion, that the political discussion about this legislation being that phenomenal opportunity to be talking about rights more generally across society. I think there's you speak about, you know, targeted work to make sure that people are who are furthest away from power, who are most often marginalised, most often excluded, is really, really important. And I think we've had discussions here before around, you know, the easy to ignore groups of people who don't have a voice. And I think this panel is one opportunity of trying to redress that balance. It doesn't go the full way. But I suppose one of the questions that comes out of what you said for me is, people need to know about their rights in order to know whether they are accessing them, whether they are realising them. But I think there's also information that's needed, probably by people in this building as well, about what we mean by you have a right to housing. You know, what does that actually mean? What kind of house? You know, is it any form of shelter over your head, or does it have to be warm, you know, secure, all of that kind of thing? And I think... Yeah, there's something about, and I'm interested in the implementation group's work. Is there something around building that understanding of what we might describe as a definition of the minimum core in terms of our obligations?
Certainly, this is forming a very key part of the discussions around the Human Rights Bill, and I think that's why we have put a focus on access to justice, because rights have to mean something, and not having them realised or not being able to access them has to mean something. So that's, and I hope I can count on the members' support in spreading these issues throughout the progress of the bill, because we need to get this right. And I appreciate the input from stakeholders and the public so far, and I hope that continues throughout the process of the bill.
Thank you. Just a quick supplementary from me. The implementation working group, who is that group responsible to?
I'll bring in Rob on this one.
Yeah, the implementation working group is one of a number of groups which are supporting the implementation, the formation of the bill, and then reports through the Director I work in, Director of Equality, Inclusion and Human Rights, and works through that. And then Minister and the Cab Sec are kept regularly updated of the work of that group and what's coming from it.
Thank you very much. Thank you for that. I'd like to now move on to my colleague Fulton, please.
Hey, thanks, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and to your team. My question is from Justin, who is in today. And he writes, the panel think that the universal bus pass policy has been a great way to tackle inequality and poverty, and that a similar approach should be used for free school meals, including removing stigma and barriers by taking away token schemes and raising the age of free meals to 18. So his question is, what has the Minister done to work with the Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise to understand the equalities impacts of the current approach to free school meals, and will she commit to carrying out work on understanding how cross-cutting successes like the Universal Bus Pass can be replicated in other policy areas to alleviate inequality?
Again, a very important question on a key policy area for the Scottish Government. I will just highlight that in terms of free school meals, we do have the most generous free school meal offer anywhere in the UK, saves parents £400 per eligible child per year. So it's an incredible investment, and we remain absolutely committed to the expansion of universal free school meals, and our programme for government has of course set out that we'll be working with COSLA to prepare schools and infrastructure for the expansion of school meals to primary 6 and 7 pupils who are eligible through the Scottish Child Payment. So the next step is there, and working with local authorities to undertake the planning work that's necessary to deliver that, recognising that, of course, there is a big infrastructure and resource requirement there on schools to deliver those school meals every day, which is something that needs to be worked through on a local basis. More broadly, I would point out that commitments like this clearly require significant funding, and we are in a very difficult budgetary situation this year and next, but it is an example of how our ongoing work on equality and human rights budgeting is making a difference, and that we are still prioritising that social justice response to poverty, climate change and our interconnected goals. So we're committed to further embedding equality and human rights budgeting, which is the role that I have in terms of not just the Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promises portfolio, but across all of government. I recently met with the Equalities Human Rights Budget Advisory Group, along with the Deputy First Minister, to discuss what more we can be doing. Of course, we've also produced an equality statement alongside the budget for over 10 years now, which represents an unbroken and consistent commitment to examine the impact of the Scottish budget on Scotland's population with that equalities lens. We've also published our response to the Equality Human Rights Budget Advisory Group's recommendations in September. In that response, we shared an overview of current and planned activity that progresses action on the recommendations, and at the heart of that response is continuing to improve how equality analysis actually improves decision making, such as with this example. And we have a ministerial workshop on equality and the budget planned for early November, and I will take this request to that workshop as fulfilling the cross portfolio working.
Yep, thanks very much, Minister, for that thorough response. And I think you've actually predicted the supplementary I was going to ask, and that was around about your role with other departments and other ministers, because I'm conscious that a lot of the questions that they have actually asked questions of other ministers, and I think you've answered them really well. But I was going to ask what specific work you're doing with ministers, how you're doing that work, but I think you've answered that. But I suppose I'll just give you a chance to reiterate. Is the example of free school meals, universal policy of free school meals, which I myself am a big supporter of, as well as Justin and the other members of the panel, is that something that does come up regularly at these meetings that you describe, the specific issue of free school meals?
I suppose all policies really do come up, because we are keen to scrutinise what we're doing constantly, and certainly any measure that's specifically aimed at supporting children out of poverty and families out of poverty, you'll know, is a core mission of the government, and where a substantial amount of our budget is currently focused in on. So as an example, we're spending over £3 billion on policies which are aimed at tackling poverty and supporting people, which will have an impact on how people can make it through the cost of living crisis and other events that they're facing. In terms of working with other ministers, it is a portfolio mine that just lends itself to doing that. So a lot of the work that we're doing, Rob as well, is mainstreaming, encouraging other ministers to think about things with an equalities and human rights lens, and also requiring them to do so through the changes that we're making to the budget process and equality duties.
Thank you. Carden?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Minister. Minister, I'm going to ask two questions. My first question is on behalf of AFAM, and my second question is based on stakeholder evidence. And before I ask the question from AFAM, I had asked them earlier if there was anything to bear in mind while asking this question, and I feel that it was quite poignant in that he said that when we talk about communities, and I'm sure he'll correct me if I'm wrong after this, but communities can often come across that word itself as othering or, you know, something at a distance from the person doing engagement with the community. And to keep in mind that we are all one community, and communities equals diversities within our whole human race community. So I will ask this question from AFAM. The panel feels very positively about the opportunity it has had to participate in the budget process and would like to see more of this work being done, especially by the Scottish Government. The question, how does the Minister connect directly with communities, and how will she work with colleagues to make sure that there are more participation opportunities across portfolios, including policy education, awareness raising of engagement opportunities, and feedback on the outcomes of engagement?
Another excellent question, and I just want to first respond by saying I'm glad that the panel members feel so positive about this process. I feel positive about it as well. It's genuinely a really good experience to be coming to committee and hearing from committee members, but also hear directly how that has been influenced by the work that the committee's undertaken engaging with the public. So yes, I feel very positive about it as well. In terms of my direct engagement with communities, Equalities, Migration and Refugees is a very people-focused portfolio. So over recess, but throughout the parliamentary term as well, there's a lot of direct engagement with people who are making use of services. You know, going back to Maggie Chapman's earlier comment about easy to ignore, I think is a far better descriptor than the too often used hard to reach, because we know where a lot of these people are. So I will engage with people directly through the Scottish Refugee Council and other bodies that we know assist people who require that extra help to engage with those in power. But also just dealing with, you know, councils and other support networks that engage directly with people, and through them I can meet with clients and people who might not, you know, think to email a minister or otherwise try and get in touch with me. I think what I'm proud of is the Scottish Government's vision for public participation. And the importance that's been placed on ensuring that people's expenses and time are paid when they are engaging, or that engagements are designed with a wide range of needs and circumstances in mind, keeping in mind that people may be travelling from rural or island communities or require accessibility measures in place before they are able to fully contribute. I think the important thing for us now is to make sure that these participation offers result in change that we can meaningfully demonstrate. So I would like to be able to come back to this committee and say, look, this is how participation has changed direction or broadened part of our policy making due to listening to what people have told us, have taken the time to explain to us. So I hope that has answered the question.
Yes, I find it really interesting how you're saying that we need to go and to reach out to these communities, because AFAM had actually mentioned that they are there, the door is open. And I think that's really important to note that we have to make that effort. You maybe just slightly covered my second question here that I'm going to ask, but the witnesses through the scrutiny process that we've done here, on the committee have said that understanding the impact of committees on the budget is challenging. And the committee's own work has shown that increasing participation in the process is valuable, but resource intensive and time consuming, especially given the lack of public awareness of the budget process. So that's the preamble. So the question is, can the minister explain how she will work with colleagues to promote participation by ensuring the budget documentation more effectively demonstrates the changes and decisions made as a result of committee scrutiny? And I suppose that's saying we are transparent and the information is there, but how can we ensure that it's coming back to us, probably in a way that is understandable and digestible?
I think I'll bring for you in a moment, but just some initial reflections on that. I think the Equalities and Fairer Scotland budget statement is an incredibly accessible document for something that is describing a very complex and large piece of work that is the budget every year. But I appreciate that we don't just want people to be involved right at the end as a look back. We want them to be involved throughout the budget process, and we are committed to improving the accessibility of the budget itself through successive open government action plans. We have worked closely with civil society partners to improve the understanding and accessibility of public finances. In the current plan, we've committed to improving the accessibility of our fiscal data and information, benchmarking our fiscal transparency against international standards, and improving public engagement and participation on the public finances. So using our research and international best practice, we have developed a prototype fiscal portal to bring together and present our fiscal data and information in a more accessible, open and understandable way. We're working to produce a fully functional minimum viable product by the end of 2023, but I'll bring in Bea to add anything around that.
I don't have very much to add, but what we're also working on at the moment is a research paper for a citizens' budget. That's going through the clearance process at the moment, and once that's been done, we can get back to you in writing with what's involved in that.
That's really fascinating. Thank you so much. Thank you, Minister.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Back to myself, I have some questions myself. In previous years and this year's, stakeholders in the committee have noted a lack of connection between policy and budget documents, and concerns about the lack of meaningful detail in the Equality and Fairer Budget Scotland statement. The Scottish Government's response to the Equality and Human Rights Budget Advisory Group recommendations includes a commitment to better align the programme for government and the budget process. So in that context, can the Minister explain how it will address the committee's previous concerns about a lack of clarity between documents in the upcoming budget round, and how the Equalities assessment process will influence this? And not only from the committee, but also in our previous sessions with our citizens' panels, that lack of connection was raised from the community level as well, was that the average citizen doesn't always see the connection between the decisions that are made and the direct impacts that it has on their lives and their communities. So how will the Minister address that?
Thank you, Convener. And I hear the criticism, and it's exactly that kind of accessibility and, you know, transparency in the process that we're trying to improve. It's not that anyone's, you know, not committed to showing our work on equality budgeting, but it's about how we best build that into the process and make sure that it's being put out in a format that is understandable. And I'll bring Rob in a moment to go in on the detail. But in terms of the programme for government, I would say that our equality, opportunity, community within the policy prospectus has given ministers, cabinet secretaries a very clear focus, and the mandate letters that you might have seen go to cabinet secretaries about their portfolios did communicate very clearly what the expectations are of this government and how we should be prioritising our core missions. So I hope that has gone some way to helping people see how all of these, you know, policy perspectives, programme for government, budget do interconnect, and how ministers are putting the work in to make sure that all of what we do is building us towards the missions that the First Minister has clearly set out. But on the process, I do appreciate there's always more we can do to increase participation and understanding more widely. Rob?
Yeah, I've just come on the point on the Equality and Fairness Scotland budget statement and the feedback from the Equality and Human Rights Budget Advisory Group. So specifically, there's the question of how do we increase that alignment between equality analysis that's done round about the programme for government time with the EFSBS, not very catchy title, work. So this year, we've taken on board that feedback both from this committee and from that group. And this year, we've made a number of significant changes. We piloted a new approach to reviewing the equality information that's contained within PFG and how that faded, and then feeding that directly into the EFSBS. So aligning those two pieces of equality analysis, and then we'll illustrate that through the published Equality and Fairness Scotland budget statement. Specifically, we've also moved some of the analysis that's done earlier in the year, which allows it to better inform decision making, which is the critical point we were trying to reach, which is it's not a post hoc analysis. It is directly informing decision making. The Minister referenced earlier on that the Minister and Deputy First Minister and others are attending a ministerial workshop on equality in the budget in November. And this information will then feed into that to allow that discussion to be well informed by evidence early on and in the budget process. So it's incremental improvements, but we're continuing to increase that alignment. And importantly, as the Minister just referenced, increase that alignment and be able to show in a transparent way how we're doing it.
Thank you. Just to get a wee bit of further reassurance about the Scottish Government's commitment to implementing the Equality Human Rights Budget Advisory Group, just in the interest of inclusivity, I don't use just initials, so we all know. The Budget Advisory Group's recommendations, can the Minister explain the funding implications of that? And are these significant or are they process-driven changes that can be met within existing budgets?
So I think this is more ably answered by Rob here, but there's certainly a focus on the process. When I've met with the chair of the Equality Human Rights Budget Advisory Group, the focus has very much been around culture and processes and the turnaround of the budget and how we can show our working throughout the process, not just at the end. So certainly a lot of it has been about that culture change and putting in place checks and balances to make sure that any minister, regardless of their portfolio, has equality and human rights budgeting in their mind, so that it becomes habit rather than something that we have to constantly drive through.
The question really, in terms of a cash cost, now this is a process improvement, so the cost is really about staff time and critically staff capability. So it's not the capability of a sort of small number of specialists in this area, but the capability of broader staff to understand and work with equality data and equality budgeting to inform decisions. So we are aware of this sort of the staff time question, but critically we're working on the staff capability questions. An example of that is we're working with the OECD, who are running a couple of pilots for us on gender budgeting specifically, and a key part of the remit we've agreed with OECD on that is that they will focus on developing staff capability, and that's that broad staff capability, not the capability of the small number of specialists like myself and Fee who work in this area.
Very much. I'd like to bring in Fulton, please.
Thanks, convener. And so just
It's a follow-up question from the discussions we've already been having. The response to the Equality and Human Rights Budget Advisory Group does make it clear that the Scottish Government does not intend to greatly increase direct engagement with the public on the budget process, and yet that's something that we've heard through our engagement sessions and doing it a wee bit differently here, that the Citizens Panel and wider public have all asked for, and there's been a real emphasis put to us about the importance of understanding lived experience in the context of spending outcomes. So I'm wondering, Minister, if you acknowledge these calls for more opportunities for the public to engage more directly with the Scottish Government in the budget process, and if so, are you able to outline why citizen-led approaches to reflect lived experience have not been incorporated into this budget setting?
We have committed to exploring opportunities to improve public engagement with the budget process and to continue to make the budget process more transparent, including through exploring a citizen's budget. So I think there is a strong commitment there, and there's definitely the will within government to hear more from people who have been empowered to make comment on the budget in a way that allows us to take that into account. And that is not just about opening opportunities for people to speak to us, but going back to making the process more clear and transparent and easy to digest, not making it an inaccessible set of documents. So I think those two things go hand in hand, because if people are empowered to understand what it is we're doing and why we're making the decisions we make, then they will be able to comment and scrutinise in a far more informed way, which is absolutely welcome by the government. So I'll just end by saying we are committed to exploring more opportunities for people to engage with the process.
And thanks, Minister. I do know that it's something that you're personally very committed to yourself. So.
Thank you. I've just got a wee follow-up to that. I mean, you may not have the answer to this. It came up during our sessions with the Citizens Panel. Sort of retrospective sort of analysis. So when budgets are set, this came from our discussions, that citizens thought, well, budgets are set, they follow policy, and then what work is done to actually analyse the impact of that? So did the money reach the right people? And what work? And as I said, I'm fully prepared for the fact that you may not have the answers today. I don't expect that. But it would be good for us to hear, I think, what work the government does do to do that impact analysis almost.
So our Equalities and Fairer Scotland budget statement does link the spending that has been undertaken with national outcomes. So that does, as a document, provide that link between what we've spent money on and how that's actually changed things for people through an Equalities lens. More generally, one of the commitments that we've made in response to the Equalities Human Rights Budget Advisory Group is to say that we are going to ensure that officials are resourced, going back to the points that Rob had been making earlier, to mainstream and to provide that retrospective look and analyse what spending has resulted in.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Thank you very much. That actually concludes this session now, and we will take some time to reflect on the evidence that we have heard. Any matters that arose during the committee of further information that the panel has offered to supply us with, we will gratefully accept that offer and look forward to getting that information from you. And we will also write to the Scottish Government in due course. So I thank the Minister for her attendance this morning, and to her officials, Rob and Fee. And on that note, I will suspend the meeting as we move into private session.